That sounds like ooh or to me.
Ooh or ah, eh.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
I think it is 2K or 1K.
Yeah.
Yes,
you're right, you're good at this.
It's definitely a little harder with the music than with just the pink noise,
for sure. It's been a minute.
I just got really insecure. That's just the reality there.
Oh no. Oh no.
You're in the ballpark.
125?
All right, I am in Long Beach, California at the Audio Engineering Society show. This is a place where audio engineers and researchers from around the world come together, talk audio stuff. So I thought, what a better place than here to test out the new Audio University Ear Training Lab. It's a tool that's designed to help you learn to EQ and mix better by training you to identify frequencies by ear. There's a free version below that you can check out. And if you decide you want to take the full 15-week course, you can find the link for that below as well. Quick shout out to the sponsor of this video, Direct Sound Headphones. I'll be using their Extreme Isolation EX29 Plus. We're going to be in some noisy environments, and we're going to be doing some critical listening. So it'll be important that we have good isolation headphones. You can learn more about Direct Sound with the link below. All right, I'm here with Catherine. We're at AES at the Education and Career Fair. You're at Berklee College of Music.
Yes, I do.
I wanted to show you this ear training tool that I've been working on. It's called the Ear Training Lab. And basically, we go down here, we're in matching mode, mm-hmm. Okay? So what we'll do is we'll play the pink noise regular, just unaffected, dry, flat. And then we'll go over to B, and it will apply a filter. It's okay. Gonna boost one of these frequencies by 12 decibels, okay?
Uh-huh.
And then on C, I want you to choose which one that is.
Target?
Yep.
So press target?
Yep.
Oh, obviously, I think.
Oh, you don't even need to check. Nice.
Next question.
Yep.
I think it was 2K.
Okay, and you can double check your answer. Nice. All right, Dominic. Dude, I think you're ready for music, and I think you're also ready for a different mode.
All right.
You're probably familiar with return to flat. So instead of just matching the frequencies,
mm-hmm.
it's more like mixing.
Okay.
Channel B will have a filter applied.
Mm-hmm.
When you go to channel C, that'll still be there, and it's up to you to apply the opposite.
And get it to there. Okay.
That's right, to return it to flat.
Okay,
so let me first get some music in here. You can just upload your own music. But you can hear that, right?
Yep.
Okay. So I'm going to pause it. I'm going to put this into return to flat mode. Now, all of these weeks of training, they come from the ear training course mm-hmm. at Audio University. But I'm going to go here. We'll go to this one so we get the return to flat mode.
Okay, let's
go ahead
try
and go
it
through
out.
A few of these, okay?
Okay.
So you'll play it.
Play.
Let's see if C and A match now. C and A. A little bit different.
Oh, no, not right. Is it up here?
Nice.
Yeah, okay.
All right, cool,
okay.
Let's keep going. Because the idea is that as you train this,
yeah.
you get better and better.
Yeah, this is my first time doing like the return to flat thing, but I like how it works,
okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I find the formal training that we've been talking about with our new tool, I find that helpful, but it's not the only thing,
right.
obviously. Like, with your students, what do you recommend to them to practice? I found that the first 2 years before Dr. Ryan came to our school and introduced the ear training, we learned a lot about tools and about techniques, but I still felt lost a little bit about,
yeah.
you know, how do I know what frequency? I understand how a parametric EQ works,
yeah.
but how do I know what frequency? Do you say just like experiment and practice, or is there a specific technique of practice that you recommend to your
students? So I think the formal training is what makes you efficient and a finely tuned audio machine, right? You know, you as an engineer go, I know exactly what frequency is the problem, I can take care of it, I can move a mic, I can do whatever I need to do. But I think maybe even more important, I've discovered over years of teaching now, when people are starting out, we go, I have a guitar amp, I have a microphone, I'm gonna put the microphone on the guitar amp, and then whatever comes out, comes out. And we don't often take the time to build ourselves a reference for what we're doing at the time. And as you develop your own aesthetic, that becomes less important. But when you're first starting out, having a target, having a goal is super important, because every drum set sounds okay if you're not trying to make a certain drum sound, right? Like, it sounds like drums. I guess that's good enough. And then you listen to your favorite band and you go, oh, my drums don't sound that good. Yeah. So building that reference into your production process, especially early in your career, I think is really important. Asking a client, what do you want to sound like? You know, do you want to sound like Stone Temple Pilots or do you want to sound like Sabrina Carpenter? The way I'm going to mic those drums is going to be wildly different. Yeah. If I even use real drums, it's going to be different, you know?
There isn't a good drum sound.
Right. Yeah. There's a lot of subjectivity, but if you never work that subjectivity into your process, you're just wandering aimlessly, hoping you find the right goal.
What are the vowel sounds that you use again?
250 is oo, 500 o, 1K, ah.
All right, here, play it again.
Okay. Here's flat.
1K.
Okay, let's hear it.
It's ah. Yeah, it's 500.
Yeah, nice adjustment.
Yeah.
While I think the EQ ear training that we have in our app, while I believe that EQ ear training is helpful for both EQ and compression and all sorts of different things. Yeah. How are you guys training your ears for compression?
So compression, it was mainly just adjusting like parameters of compression and comparing them. So it would be like a ABCD style answer and you would get four different recordings and they would be labeled and it would be like, can you tell? You get four recordings, one of them would be 2:1, one of them would be 4:1, one of them would be 10:1, and the other would be 20:1. And you would listen to the four of them, and then you would have to match them with, oh, this letter A, recording A is 10:1, and then listen back to them back and forth and figure out, oh, this one sounds less compressed, so it's 2:1, this one sounds way compressed, so it's 20:1, or whatever.
Yeah. For me, the EQ ear training came along with the Forman method, which was I think the most powerful part, the vowel sound method.
Yeah.
I know that 250 hertz is ooh. So on. For compression, is there a similar cue system?
Or I don't just think so.
This is more compressed.
It's mainly just listening to more and less compressed, and then
have you found anything that you hear it and you're like, oh, that is a characteristic of a faster attack or a slower release?
Not necessarily that I feel like I could extrapolate on.
It's more just doing it over and over again.
Yeah.
And you get a natural feel.
Yeah, and like,
I think that's what we're all going for.
I think that's kind of, especially as a student, it's like just being able to articulate. I don't know, you have a lot of these guys that like, they talk very technical and advanced, and it's kind of intimidating to a lot of people. But as a student, I feel like it's important to just be able to like know the bass and like being able to do the quizzes and listening and going, this one just sounds more compressed or less compressed, and not necessarily knowing how to talk about it, but just like listening and knowing that like this one is more compressed than this one or whatever.
All right, I'm at AES and I've got David and I've got DK and we're gonna do a challenge, all right? These guys are colleagues, they're friends, and I heard, what, best of three?
Best of three.
DK is gonna start, let's do this. Yeah, okay. Oh, that was a quick answer.
Okay, all right.
Passing it over.
I feel like you gotta do like the chest.
The timer.
The timer.
Yep. All right.
What was it?
It's currently, it was 4K.
It was 4.
So it's currently 1-0, right? Best of three.
That's all right.
All right, tough competition. Yeah? Go ahead.
Light switch it.
Oh, man.
Light work.
Game point.
That's all right.
Clenched it. All right.
Those are the hard ones. 4 to 2 is hard.
When I was doing the ear training class at my school, I did 3 semesters of it. And by the end of that, we got to like multiple filters, plus or minus 3 dB.
That's really
it was amazing,
that
yeah.
Really
but
awesome.
Again, I want to reiterate, it's not the only way to do this.
Yeah.
So what are some ways that you found, did you start as a in your early part of learning, thinking, what do I even listen for? I feel lost with
it. I'm gonna be totally honest. I started out as like just someone who wanted to like make music in their bedroom, just messing around with stuff. And then when I got to college, it was like, this is a very serious thing. I had to learn Pro Tools on the fly. And once Justin Kurtz had started talking about EQ, it was something that I hadn't exactly thought about before. So I was just, you know, letting him talk us through it. And then also using WebTech, it was something that I had to learn, obviously. And as I went, it started making a little bit more sense because originally I had no experience with that going in.
Yeah, you were just a creator creating.
Yeah.
Have you found, I was talking to Charlie from my old school and we were saying that like, it's important to marry those two things together. The technical side helps, but don't lose that creative.
Don't lose the artistic side. I will always be someone who will support the artistic side. I am someone who still kind of struggles with the technical side. It is important to know, no doubt, but I've known enough people who've gotten burnt out just really going in on the technical stuff and then they lose themselves to it. And
yeah, they lose why they started in the first place,
they
right?
They lose their artistic sense. And it's something that I don't want people who are new to audio and this whole world to lose when they start learning.
Yes. I think that's one thing I really appreciate about Gabe Herman, who we were talking about.
Absolutely.
He, in our live group coaching sessions each month, he often says things that make me think, oh wow, that excites me in a way that the technical stuff, the right way to do it, never did. For example, rather than using a saturator plugin or rather than using any plugin, send the snare signal out of the interface, out of the digital realm, put it in a guitar amplifier or something, record that. And that actually makes
kind
you...
Kind of reamping, but using a speaker to just reamp the snare.
Yeah. Well, it's creative.
Yes, it is creative. It is cool. It is, you know, not something you'd usually think to do,
right.
But you can really just... When you're just messing around, you can find cool stuff.
Yes. And I think that the same is obviously true for being a musician.
Yes.
But then I thought, okay, there's like the musician and that's where it's creative. And then there's the engineer and that's where it's all technical.
No, it is.
But actually everything, yes, everything
being,
is, don't you think?
Yes. Completely agree. Being just that, say the guy behind the board, it is an art form in of itself. And the way that Gabe Herman, sort of described it, he said, this mix board is an instrument in and of itself, and you will learn it. You will learn it like you do any other instrument that you study here at the Hart School. And it's something that stuck with me all my years at the Hart School, now that I'm graduated, and it still sticks with me.